Hi, I hope I'm live. Welcome to the question answer sessions on the rules of procedure for the 41st World Scout Conference happening this summer in August 2017 in Baku, Azerbaijan. I am David Burke. I'm the Global Director for Organizational Development in the World Scout Bureau. And I'm going to try to lead you through the major changes the World Scout Committee is proposing for the upcoming World Scout Conference in terms of how we will handle decision making. Let me see if I can get my presentation rolling. Yes, okay, these are flags. This is the logo of the conference, in case you don't know it yet. There's a lot of fire in Azerbaijan, so it will, I guess, be a fiery conference. So how is this presentation going to roll out? First of all, I'm going to give you an overview of the changes proposed and why we are proposing those, what were the key rationale behind reviewing the 2014 procedure. Then I will be explaining you how the postal ballot is working, because it's not a World Scout committee or some high-level working groups who decide how the World Scout Conference runs. It's actually you, 164 national scout organizations, who decide how the conference conducts its business. And this decision-making is handled prior to the conference, and we do that through a method called postal ballot. And I'll explain you a little bit how that procedure works in case you have any questions around that. And then I'll be open for any questions coming from the floor. You can already type now any questions you have or during the presentation into the chat box or into the questions which you see down below the... If you look down below the screen of the crowdcast, you see a button which you can click and ask questions. And then at the end of the presentations, I'll go through each one of those and answer them. And you can interact through the chat channel constantly. Also with me on the call is Linda Rainbow, who is also a member of the Global Team for Organizational Development. And she has been one of the key staff members actually running the whole review process. And she will be assisting me in trying to go through this smoothly. I hope we'll be able to wrap this up in 30 to 45 minutes, but I'll be available for a full hour if needed. And thank you all for joining from all over the world. We are, I think, between 15 and 20 people joining for this first session. And we'll be running these sessions, well, not me personally, but we'll be running them in 5 different languages. And there will be also a second iteration of the English session later this week on Friday. More details can be found on the Facebook page of WOSM under the events. So let's get started. Where do these changes come from? As usual, when we organize an event, we look at the evaluation of the last iteration of it. When we looked at what delegates told us about the decision-making at the last World Scout conferences, and I'm saying this in plural because we looked at multiple evaluations going back all the way to Tunis, Korea, Brazil and Slovenia. One thing which comes up consistently is that delegates felt that they didn't receive the information particularly related to decision-making well in advance. So this is not about hotel rooms. This is about like what is actually being decided by the conference. And delegates felt that the key information, the key proposals came too late in the conference for them to be adequately prepared to talk them through with their own NSO. But also with other NSOs, which they met during the conference. The actual resolutions up until 2014, the draft resolutions, as you might recall, are under the old rules of procedure only released approximately 36 hours before the actual plenary session on the voting takes place. And that means many NSOs felt, well, we only get these during the conference 36 hours before or even less, usually only in English and only later in French and not in any additional language, and people felt, well, there's just not enough time to discuss those and actually understand what the impact is of the of these proposals. So that's like the kind of start where we went from. And so the WorldScout committee asked the planning team of the WorldScout conference to do a review and come with change proposals of how we can increase and strengthen the decision making of WOSM's major institutional body, the WorldScout conference. To do that, a small group of volunteers and staff went looking at how do others do it, because we're not alone in this world, we're not the only ones running conferences. So we went looking at best practices from other international NGOs. We also went looking, we contacted, I think, about 20 national scout organizations around the world, particularly those who run bigger general assemblies or national councils or however you would like to call it, but big groups of people coming together to make a decision, as there's a similarity there with how we run the World Scout Conference in terms of size and how do you deal with many people coming together and at the same time having to give strategic guidance. So we went looking like, how do others do it? And then we went out to do, based on the challenges which we found in the evaluation, we talked to a large number of individuals to better understand what does this mean that you say you don't get the information well enough in advance? What does this mean when you say like we don't have time to discuss this with our peers during the conference? Based on that, we developed a number of change proposals, which I will walk you through in a sec. We also, when we had those initial change proposals, we asked feedback from a number of volunteer groups on the world level. That included members of the World Scout Committee, but also in particular the youth advisors and the planning team of the World Scout Youth Forum, because these changes, any changes to the World Scout Conference procedures also affect the World Scout Youth Forum. So let's get into the proposed changes. The aim, which you see from this large slide, is actually to increase the to strengthen WOSM's decision-making process. And there's four like pillars which we try to strengthen. We want to streamline the process in which we take decisions, that it's clearer from people around the world from how decisions are drafted up until they are voted at the conference. It is a clear process and not haphazardly, where people felt it's unclear for us how a resolution comes to be. We also want decisions to be more inclusive, in particular taking different cultures into account of how decisions are taken. The way decisions are taken in the United States is different than decisions are taken in Tanzania, is different than how decisions are taken in Singapore. And so we wanted to look at how how can we make sure that the process and the way in which we make decisions takes into account these different cultures and views on debates and procedures. Now, it's one thing to make sure that everybody knows how results come to be and that everybody feels from their own cultural perspective that they can adequately contribute. Another thing is, of course, people told us we want to make sure that resolutions are relevant for the body that the conference is, which means they need to be on a strategic level and they don't need to go about how many books WOSM should produce around a specific topic. They should have an adequate enough level, a strategic enough level to be relevant for the World Scout Conference. And then finally, one thing we looked into is once we have a streamlined process where people felt they can contribute from different cultures with resolutions which are appropriate on a strategic enough level, is that people actually have a deeper understanding of what will be the impact of the proposed resolution on a financial level. What will this mean? What will it mean like in terms of historical changes of policy? So these kind of elements were brought into the equation as well. And that's what we hope to achieve with the changes proposed. A streamlined process, more inclusive towards all cultures in the world to make sure that resolutions are relevant for the strategic body that the World Scout Conference is, and that delegations acquire a deeper understanding of the impact the proposed decision would have on WOSM's policies and services towards national scout organizations. Let me walk through each of the pillars to propose you the changes which are included in the rules of procedure. So, streamlined process. And this is the key change which you might have heard about already in online discussions. To enable the three other pillars to make sure that we can make the debates more inclusive, make sure people are more aware and have a deeper understanding of the impact of discussions and make sure they are on an adequate level and help NSOs to ensure their resolutions are on a strategic level. We, the World Scout Committee, feels that one of the key things we need to do is to move the deadline for the submission of draft resolutions forward. In specific terms, that means the World Scout Committee will commit itself to release its proposed resolutions 4 months before the World Scout Conference. That gives NSOs 4 months of time to look at the specific measures the World Scout Committee itself is proposing of how WOSM should move forward. It also gives time for NSOs to reflect if it agrees with the proposals of the World Scout Committee or if it would like to propose itself resolutions. The deadline proposed for resolutions by national scout organizations is 3 months before the World Scout Conference, which translates to the 14th of May, 2017. The deadline for submitting amendments is also something new. As you might recall, up until 2014, we accepted amendments from the floor during the resolution session itself, and this was felt particularly by non-English speakers. They felt disproportionately excluded from a debate with 1,000 people where amendments are filed directly from the floor of the conference during the debate itself to understand actually what amendments mean. So a proposal is put forward by the World Scout Committee to still allow amendments, no question there, of course, to still allow them during the World Scout Conference. But to close deadline, to close the receiving of amendments the third day of the World Scout Conference at 1400 hours, as you see. So this means like the moment we would go into the resolution session at the World Scout Conference, you would actually have a list before you of the proposed resolutions, those you would have long before, but also the proposed amendments. So you would have time in advance to look at those amendments with your delegation, talk with other delegates from other NSOs, and actually have a much more clear view of how the decision-making will roll out, which will actually streamline the whole process and will enable you as a delegation to fully understand what amendments are being proposed in advance of the actual decision session. Now, why do we propose that? Because you might think, well, like, why do we need to submit the resolution so much in advance? We're not the only ones. We're actually the only organization so far which allows resolutions to be submitted at the conference itself. When we look at international NGOs, we talk to WACS, we talk to the Red Cross, we talk to the World Wildlife Fund, a total of, I see at the graph well on the left side, six NSOs. The only NSO which allows resolutions to be proposed is WOSM itself. You see it there, is 1 day before, but this is us. All the others, the five others, require at least a month or more to submit their draft resolutions in advance of the conference. And so this is exactly what we are proposing, also to align ourselves with international best practice, where we see many of our other INGOs requesting draft resolutions to be submitted in advance of the conference to allow delegates to have a better view of the proposals being submitted. Now, it's not only other international NGOs. If you look at national scout organizations, how do they deal with resolutions or policy proposals for their general assemblies, which is the chart on the right? From the approximately 15 NSOs we surveyed, 11 of those request at least 1 month in advance to get draft proposals from their delegates, which might be districts or local groups, but they require also that these would be proposed before the World Scout Conference. And even those which go lower, there's very few actually who allow resolutions to be proposed at their General Assembly itself. All of them almost require, except like two or three exceptions we identified in our group of 15 NSOs we surveyed, they all require at least a couple of days in advance to get the resolutions from their delegates on a local level. So we're not proposing rocket science here. I mean, proposing receiving draft resolutions in advance of the World Scout Conference, so allowing delegates proper time to discuss this with their own national scout organization, is something which is actually practiced in a lot of international NGOs and in our own national scout organizations. Now, we also try to understand, like, how does this impact you if the resolutions are only submitted at the conference, as we have done for a long time at World Scout conferences. And one of the things we found out is that when we surveyed NSOs, delegates from NSOs who were at World Scout conferences, and particularly those who don't have fluent English capacity as a second language, they say they feel much more than others feel it much more difficult to understand what actually the proposals are. They only get the draft resolutions, which are often developed in a complex English language, in a complex level of English. They only get them at the moment, at most 6 hours before the actual session, and they feel this is very difficult for us to understand what actually is being proposed, given the complex level of English. It's also usually not available in any of the three other languages of WOSM, and also the French language often only becomes available later during the day. So we see particularly that non-native English speakers or NSOs which don't have a large capacity of English as a second language are much more highly struggling with this. And this is, as you can imagine, something which concerns us, because one of the things the World Scout Committee wanted is to give more NSOs, to include more NSOs in the decision-making at a culturally appropriate level. One of the things they also said is, from a cultural perspective, many NSOs who do not come from Anglo-Saxon or Western societies feel anxious to table or to discuss immediately discussions in a large group like the World Scout Conference plenary hall is like 1,500 people in a hall. And they say we would be much more comfortable if there was an option for us in advance, a couple of days before the actual decision is being taken at the World Scout Conference, to have actually small breakout groups on these resolutions proposed. So we can actually, in a small group, understand from the proposal itself, from the NSO itself, what is being proposed, why this NSO feels this is important, and we can then have, in a small group, a debate with them. The current system, which we practice until Slovenia, does not allow for that, because actually the resolutions are only available at most the day before the actual decision-making session. And so the agenda does not allow for that. If we have the resolutions more in advance, before the conference, we can actually schedule, and this is our plan to schedule during the conference, on the second day, breakout sessions per proposed resolutions, where in a small group, the proposing NSO can explain to other delegates why it feels a particular proposed resolution is relevant for WOSM. So all in all, we feel we determined by talking to delegates that having resolutions proposed only a day before at the World Scout Conference leads to decreased participation in the decision-making process. It also feels if they are only receiving a resolution, a text of a resolution in complex English 36 hours before the actual vote, that it's difficult for NSOs to understand. So what does this mean financially? If we say that we need to have a focus on, say, safe from harm and child protection with WOSM worldwide in the next 3 years, what will this mean financially for WOSM? Is there, like, do we actually have the means to do that? How does this, like, relate to other decisions taken in the past by the World Scout Conference and the World Scout Committee on child protection policies? Is there a difference with the proposal here being tabled vis-a-vis earlier? Many delegations feel with the very late submission, which we practiced until Slovenia, is that they only get this information one day before they have taken a decision, and it's very hard for them to fully understand what will be the impact of such a decision. So again, if we would have more time to actually circulate resolutions and to analyze this, we feel NSOs might be would be better informed on the proposed decision and the impact, which will come now in the other pillars. But just to explain to you, we're not proposing to have an advanced deadline for resolutions just because we think it's nice to have them in advance. We truly believe it will enable us to increase, to involve more people in decision-making, to have more people informed about the proposals on the table, and to interact much more during the conference in smaller groups about what actually, why certain NSOs feel their proposal is important for the conference to consider. As another measure to increase inclusiveness of the decision-making during the World Scout Conference, the World Scout Bureau is going to endeavor to translate all the documents, including resolutions and amendments, into 5 working languages. As you might recall, up until Slovenia, although we have interpretation in the 5 languages, simultaneous interpretation, the documents are only distributed in English and French, and we're going to do a conscious effort to try to make all the documents, all the proposed resolutions, and all the amendments available in the 5 working languages. Additionally, if we have all the draft resolutions in 3 months before the World Scout Conference, we're actually going to use technology webinars like this to actually engage and inform delegations before the World Scout Conference. So we don't need to wait until we are all together in Baku, but we can actually with crowdcasts, with online platforms on Facebook, actually have discussions about the proposed resolutions. So it's actually really an initiative here to move forward from only having face-to-face discussions to try to do this in advance as well of the conference, so people can come well prepared and also discuss proposals with their NSO leadership before they leave to the World Scout Conference. Third pillar is to make resolutions more relevant. How do we make sure resolutions are on a strategic enough level for the World Scout Conference? We developed 2 new resources for that. We developed guidelines for the resolutions and amendments, which are an integral part of the rules of procedure proposed for the 2017 World Scout Conference. And the guidelines also include, if you have reviewed the documentation, you will have noted that there's a workbook in there which will help National Scout Organizations to actually develop a resolution and take the different elements into account and understand, like, what is a strategic level and what is an operational level best left to the World Scout Committee or the World Scout Bureau. It's strategic to this, to say we need to have a higher focus on child protection. If the amount of books we need to produce or the amount of people who need to be trained is a decision probably better left to the World Scout Committee or the World Scout Bureau based on actual funding available and an exact research of needs. So those guidelines of how we make sure resolutions are at an adequate level are provided already in the rules of procedure. Then another measure we propose is that for each draft resolution, be it of the World Scout Committee or an NSO, we will develop a background information paper, which will be a short one pager or even less, half a page, but which will give a neutral impact, and I stress the word neutral here, in the financial implications of implementing the proposed resolution. What will it cost to actually do this in terms of US dollars, or in terms of staff time, or in terms of required volunteer time? So that's one element which will be included in the background paper. Like, if you, so you are aware as an NSO, if you vote this, what actually financial implications would be, and if we could do it, or if we would have to make choices, if we want to do this, then maybe, yeah, we will need to cut on other things because the financial implication would be very high. It would also give an overview of how it would impact, the proposed resolution would impact current policy of WOSM. If it is diverging from what we have done so far and why that is. Again, we will endeavor to do that in a neutral fashion. Also, the historical implications, like if prior decisions or debates have been had at a World Scout Conference, if a particular resolution has been debated at previous World Scout Conference, we would make a note of that with reference to the report of that particular World Scout Conference where there was already a debate or a resolution on that particular topic. So this page, which is added to each proposed draft resolution, would give you, as a National Scout Organization, in a neutral way, an insight in the financial, the financial impact, the policy impact, and the historical relevance of a resolution proposed. This background information paper will be shared prior to be made public with the proposing NSO. So, if you propose a draft resolution, the World Scout Bureau will develop this background information paper based on its expertise and doing that in a neutral fashion. But you will see it as a proposing NSO before it is released to the public, and you will have an opportunity, if you do not agree, even if we will endeavor to do this very neutral, you will have an opportunity, if you don't agree, to write an additional short note why you feel the financial analysis, the financial impact the World Scout Bureau sees of a resolution might not be as you see. So, relevant resolutions. Finally, acquiring a deeper understanding. And for this, one of the measures proposed is we want a group of volunteers, which we already currently have during a conference. It's called the Resolutions Committee, who facilitate the resolutions and decision-making process during the conference. We want them to become more active before the conference already, because we will have resolutions coming in much earlier. So we want this group of of volunteers to start supporting National Scout Organization much earlier in the process to help them draft resolutions, but also to facilitate webinars in advance in the months leading up to the conference around the topics proposed, so there can already be a debate happening before the conference. And they will also facilitate the breakouts during the conference. To do that, we will increase the amount of members in the resolutions committee. We'll move them from 4 to 6 members, and we'll have a particular focus there to make sure that they have a broad language capacity within those 6 and also a broad cultural diversity. So that is particularly taken into account when resolutions are being developed and NSOs request support from the resolutions committee, like, can you help to tweak this resolution so it is appropriate from a cultural perspective, that the resolutions committee can give feedback from that based on its expertise. Now, you might say, well, this is all very nice, but there might be a reason why the conference needs to take decisions on the spot. Something urgent and important might happen. There might be a crisis, be it a global crisis outside WOSM affecting the organization. It might also be an internal crisis where there is a need that even with all our advanced processes and options for debate, that there might be urgent and important situations where the conference needs to take a decision. And the World Scout Committee clearly does not want to remove this power from the conference. This is why we developed the concept of emergency resolutions. So for those resolutions which are considered urgent and important, and an NSO proposing such an emergency resolution would have to add a short rationale why it feels so, they can still be proposed during the conference, much like the how we did it up until Slovenia. So the deadline to submit emergency resolutions would be August 16th, which is the third day, the Wednesday of the conference, up until 1400. Now, to avoid that everybody just submits emergency resolutions, we increase the threshold for a emergency resolution, which means that an NSO willing to submit such an emergency proposal needs to find 9 NSOs seconding it, coming from 3 different regions. This is done on purpose to make sure that, particularly the 3 different regions, to make sure that the urgency and the importance is felt globally, not only by one particular region, but is felt across a multiple variety of cultures, which is in itself then a short representation of the conference. So it will still be possible to propose resolutions on the spot on the condition that they are urgent and important and have an initial backing of a number of NSOs, 9 NSOs from 3 different regions. So how does this translate in a timeline, all these proposals? The first major milestone we will hit if these rules of procedure are approved, is the deadline to submit constitutional amendments. This is something which is linked to the WOSM constitution. It's not so much linked to the rules of procedure. We have always in the past requested NSOs who want to submit constitutional amendments to submit them 6 months in advance to the World Scout Bureau. 6 months before the World Scout Conference will be February 14, Valentine's Day. And that gives the opportunity for the World Scout Committee to review the proposed constitutional amendments by NSOs, and they will be released according to the WOSM Constitution 4 months before the World Scout Conference. As you see, 4 months before the World Scout Conference, this is also the deadline when the World Scout Committee will release their draft resolution. So they meet in March for the final time to do the final agreement on what they propose to the World Scout Conference. And on April 14, we will publish all the World Scout Committee policy proposals for the World Scout Conference. So you will have those as National Scout Organization 4 months in advance. 1 month later, the deadline, the proposed deadline for National Scout Organization which is 3 months before the World Scout Conference, which is May 14, 2017. Then there is a month between May 14 and June 14 in which the World Scout Bureau will consolidate all the draft resolutions We'll translate them, we'll endeavor to translate them into 5 languages. We'll add these background information papers to it, and we will release them no later than June 14, 2017. If we can, we will release them earlier. We're not necessarily committed to release them all in one block on June 14. If some are earlier, we will already release them as they become available and are translated and are foreseen by the background information paper. So you can actually see resolutions building on our website as they become available. But no later than June 14, 2017, 2 months before the World Scout Conference, all draft resolutions will be available to all delegates. And then you see there the 2 months. There will be 2 months for discussions and debate, which we will try to do through webinars like this and other methods, where the Resolutions Committee will facilitate discussions around the proposals being made. Then at the World Scout Conference itself, we will have, it's not mentioned on the slide, but on day two, I mean, on day one, we do the opening and celebrate that we are all together. On day two, we will have breakouts on this specific resolutions proposal. These will be the small discussion groups in a smaller group on all the resolutions. So as an NSO, if you are proposing a resolution, you will have the opportunity to run a breakout yourself. We will facilitate that and actually make a case to a smaller group of delegates why you feel this is important, and actually interact with them on proposed amendments. So you will not be hit on the floor with amendments, but you will actually have a discussion to debate with your fellow National Scout organizations how your proposed resolutions could possibly be improved by amendments. Such amendments will have to be submitted on the third day of the World Scout Conference at 1400 hours latest. And that's also the same deadline for draft emergency resolutions. Remember, those are the resolutions which are urgent and important in nature, which could not have been filed prior to the conference, but are felt like, okay, these absolutely need to be debated by the conference itself on the condition that they are seconded by at least 9 NSOs from 3 different regions. And if all goes well, then on the third day of the World Scout Conference, in the morning, we will have the plenary session on the draft resolutions where the formal vote will take place. But by then, we will have had 2 months of discussions and debates. Prior to the conference, we will have had small breakout sessions during the conference proposed by NSOs, and you will have had a list of the amendments prior to the actual debate to review with your delegation and with other delegations, so you know when you go into the big room with the 1,000 other delegates of what exactly the discussion will be, what exactly the proposals will be, and you will have had time to review them. And you will have had them, we will endeavor you have had them in 5 different working languages, so as many people as possible can be included in the process. So these are the changes we propose. As I said at the beginning of this presentation, this is a proposal of the World Scout Committee, and it's up to the 164 National Scout Organizations worldwide to consider if they approve these changes or not. And we're doing a lot of effort to make people aware that there are changes, that it's not business as usual, as we did in Slovenia, but that we're making changes on how we take decisions, which is why we're doing these webinars. Constitutionally, we are doing a postal ballot, which we released on November 23rd through an official circular, but you saw no doubt our videos as well online, explaining in a brief manner the changes proposed. And also, additionally, there's also a video that chairperson of the upcoming World Scout Youth Forum explaining the impact on the World Scout Youth Forum specifically. You can vote yes or no, one vote per National Scout Organization, and you submit the ballot to charlesing@scout.org, and we would be very happy if you do so by January 8, 2017, because we need, of course, time to further prepare the conference, and having an approval for the rules of procedure is crucial in terms of preparing the further institutional process and all the elements which need to fall into place. So a kind request to all of you to come out for the vote and send it in. And with this, I think, yes, I finished this presentation, and I'm now open for questions from the floor, which I will do my best to answer. Thank you. So I think you all now see me. That's cool, instead of a presentation. So let me first take a drink. Okay, I will take the first question from Stefan. Thank you, Stefan, for posting a question. I will read the question now. As the deadline is very early, interregional collaboration on different topics will be most likely low or at least challenging. Informal meetings in the different regions can be used to exchange and work on certain topics. Is there any tool slash platform to facilitate interregional slash global collaboration and or provide an overview which NSOs are working on which topic? Yes. Two elements to my answer. We have intensively worked already with the regional committees, so they can actually help their NSOs to understand what that kind of proposals are being considered. You will also get the proposals of the World Scout Committee early. And in terms of platform, we will make this available on scout.org. So there will be a page on scout.org where you will see, which will be managed by the resolution committee, where you will see which NSOs are working on certain topics. So even if there's no resolution text yet, you would see like the Boy Scouts of America is working on a resolution around child protection, and maybe the Scouts of Bangladesh are working on a resolution around environmental protection. Just saying topics here randomly. And that would actually enable you to contact. We'll try to make contacts there so you can actually then reach out to the Boy Scouts of America or Bangladesh if you're interested in such a topic to actually liaise with the concerned NSO to discuss. Again, the opportunity remains to discuss at the conference itself and to propose amendments to resolutions, but you will see in advance the topics being discussed even prior to that the actual resolution text is available. I hope that's an answer, Stefan. So I'll take the next question. How will the outputs of the World Scout Youth Forum be dealt with? Will World Scout Youth Forum amendments to the resolutions become automatic amendments for vote, or will they have to be adopted by a national scout organization? Thank you, Stefan, again. Also in the past, I mean, this is no change from prior practice. Any amendments proposed by the World Scout Youth Forum will have to be endorsed by national scout organizations. There's no change there. This was also the case in Slovenia. Now, the big advantage here for the World Scout Youth Forum is this will be the first body coming together on a global level prior to the World Scout Conference, which will have all the draft resolutions available. So in 2014, there were no draft resolutions available to the World Scout Youth Forum. The only thing they had was a triennial plan and whatever they came up with themselves. Now the Youth Forum will have, as the first body, all the draft resolutions available and will be able with the delegates of the Youth Forum to actually seek like where, as representatives of young people worldwide, do we feel that there should be amendments or tweaks to certain resolutions. So these amendments will be taken forward into the World Scout Conference, but will need to be backed up by NSOs as this is part of the normal procedure in decision-making. Now, we will, for example, make sure when we have these small breakout sessions on each of the proposed draft resolutions, which I explained earlier on the second day of the World Scout Conference, we will make sure these amendments proposed by the World Scout Youth Forum are proposed in those small breakout groups. So if you are an NSO, say I'm the NSO from Germany, I have a draft resolution around advocacy. This draft resolution has been debated at the World Scout Youth Forum, and there are two amendments. We will make sure there's a representative from the World Scout Youth Forum in the small breakout where Germany presents its resolution to interested NSOs and why it feels important that there is a representative from the World Scout Youth Forum saying like the World Scout Youth Forum felt these and these amendments would be necessary. And then it's up to NSOs in the room, of course, to consider if they take forward this particular amendment. But we feel that actually it empowers the youth forum substantially because it will have, as the first body, all the proposed resources on the table and will have the first opportunity to have face-to-face discussions with the with the different delegates and see if resolutions are valid or not. So I hope this is an answer on the World Scout Youth Forum.
David, there's an additional question there from Elena.
There's an additional question
in the comment part of the question that says, how many NSOs has to support the Vietnam amendment?
How many NSOs? That depends on the guidelines of the World Scout Youth Forum. At the moment, the guidance of the World Scout Youth Forum requires a proposing NSO to submit an amendment, and it needs to be seconded by another NSO. But this only impacts a proposal of the World Scout Youth Forum. If it is taken forward into the conference, there's again the requirement that an NSO picks this up and it is seconded. For normal amendments, this is just like only one NSO proposing and one NSO seconding, no more. I think the next questions, are amendments on the floor possible either by the proposer or others? Question by Chris Polity. Amendments from the floor for normal resolutions will not be possible. You will have to submit your amendments in advance. But up until, you will be able to submit them up until 1400 of the third day of the World Scout Conference. This links into streamlining the process. One of the things we learned from many NSOs, particularly those who are not fluent in English, is if that the resolutions, the amendments proposed from the floor directly lead to a large confusion with non-native English speaker NSOs disproportionately in understanding what actually the amendment is proposed and how the amendment impacts the proposed decision. So that's why we will request those amendments to be submitted one day before the actual session. So it will be during the conference. You will have 3 days to debate with fellow NSOs about proposed amendments, and that will also enable us to translate them in advance in the 5 languages. So everybody will have an overview of all the resolutions, the proposed amendments, and we can go through a streamlined process to discuss each of those. For emergency resolutions, amendments from the floor will be possible. The emergency resolutions, because they are urgent and important, we presume that there is a need to have a direct debate on the floor with the World Scout Conference. So they will be, after they have been taken into consideration by the conference, amendments from the floor on emergency resolutions submitted by 9 NSOs, 3 regions, will be directly amendable. I hope this is... Jose Arroyo, I see, and if changes in the resolution text is to be suggested on the floor, no. I mean, amendments in the proposed rules of procedure, amendments need to be proposed on the day before. Similar amendments to the amendments, our learning from talking to many NSOs and delegates is that this confuses the process, so we will require all amendments to be submitted the day before the actual session at 1400. When an amendment is proposed, the moment it goes to the floor, the proposing NSO will have an opportunity to comment why it feels this amendment is important and has a last opportunity to either remove the amendment from the floor or give it to consideration for the floor. We will not enter into amendments on amendments and also not in amendments on amendments on amendments. So we intend to close the amendments insertion at 1400 the day before the plenary session. Again, this is not something we are getting out of nowhere. We believe we have seen this happening in many international NGOs, that this happens like this. We have seen this happening in many national scout organizations. And we believe it will streamline the process and will increase the inclusiveness of decision-making towards non-native English speakers or towards people who do not have English as their second language. So I hope this answers the question, if amendments to the amendments on the floor are possible. Under 3E, I think the next question, in the proposed ROP, it states that members of the resolutions committee will be part of their national delegations. Does this imply that the NSO foots the bill for them, effectively precluding smaller organizations with fewer resources from nominating qualified candidates? Historically, the resolutions committee has always been drawn from delegates at the World Scout Conference. from delegations at the WorldSCAD conference. The members could either be delegates or observers, but they were always drawn from delegations at the WorldSCAD conference. So we're not proposing a change here. We're only expecting that candidates proposed by NSOs for the resolutions committee are already part of the delegation of their NSO to the WorldSCAD conference. WOSM has never in the past sponsored the participation of members of the resolutions committee to the WorldSCAD conference. So we're not proposing changes. This is how it has been. If the NSO foots the bill for them or not, this is a question for the NSO. I mean, some NSOs require their delegates to pay their own way. Other NSOs provide support. This is a local NSO decision in which WOSM does not interfere. But when it comes to NSOs with fewer resources, of course, WOSM has an interest that as many delegations as possible participate to the WorldSCAD conference, and the host of the WorldSCAD conference, the NSO of Azerbaijan, has in place a solidarity program for A and B countries to support those to be able to attend the conference. So we're not precluding. We only request that members of the resolution committee are part of delegations. If an NSO has fewer resources, there is a solidarity program in place to which an NSO can apply to get support for its delegates to go to the WorldSCAD conference. I hope this answers the question, Chris. If amendments are made to conference documents, there is a reduced need for separate resolutions. Therefore, I would like to know whether the conference documents will be released before the resolutions deadline. Yes, particularly the triennial plan is actually approved through a resolution. So the triennial plan will be released 4 months before the opening of the WorldSCAD conference. So you will have triennial plan at the latest on the 14th of April. The triennial plan can be amended as we did in Slovenia. So you will be able to file amendments on the triennial plan up until the third day of the WorldSCAD conference. So you'll have the opportunity to have the plan 4 months in advance before the WorldSCAD conference, the proposed triennial plan. You have opportunity of small sessions and webinars to debate in advance of the conference and to discuss with your national leadership if you support this triennial plan or if you see amendments needed. You have an opportunity at the conference itself in small breakout groups to discuss the plan and then propose amendments up until the Wednesday of the conference to the plan. So absolutely yes, the conference documents will be made available 4 months before the conference, all those linked to resolutions. I hope this is an answer, Celia. I see a question from Arnaud, I think. The ROB prohibits any plenary discussion except for clarifications, which increases the likelihood of uninformed choices, especially for delegations with limited human resources, which can't take part in all breakout sessions. Is there a good way to better mitigate this? Yes, in particular, because we will facilitate webinars like this in advance on all the different resolutions. So even if you are not able to split yourself into six different parts to attend six different sessions, if you're only one member for your whole delegation, you will be able in advance of the conference to take part in webinars on the different resolutions proposed. There will also be breakout sessions, so you can choose, and we will run those breakout sessions multiple times. So you will have an opportunity to choose multiple. Now, of course, there's a limit to that. If there are 10 resolutions proposed, we'll not like run 10 times a session, obviously. But yes, I mean, and we believe that the whole process actually will lead to more informed choice. So we do not believe that the rules of procedure will increase the likelihood of uninformed choices. We believe that having the resolutions in advance will actually, particularly for smaller NSOs, enable them to have a clear overview of all the proposals which are on the table, to particularly single those out where it has questions about, go specifically during in advance of the conference, during webinars, talk to those NSOs which are having resolutions where you have questions about, and actually during the conference, from the moment you arrive, you know immediately what's on the table, and you can go to those NSOs where you have something like, well, this is a bit weird, why do you propose this? You will have the opportunity to go directly to them instead of having to wait 3 days and getting them only on the third day, only in English. So, I mean, we think we have a number of places, a number of elements in place to mitigate any risk for small delegations. I hope this answered the question, Chrissy, and thank you for asking. I will now take the top question. Although it is not likely to happen, what if the committee wants to submit an emergency proposal? Good question. I think the same, I would say the same rule would apply. The committee would have to find 9 NSOs. First of all, I think, as you say yourself, Arnaud, it's unlikely to happen. But if such is the case, I think it would have to find, adhere to the same rules it implies to all members, and it would have to find 9 NSOs from 3 different regions to second its emergency proposal before it can be taken into consideration. It's unlikely to happen, but then again, this is why we have the system of emergency resolution. So I hope that answers. They will also need 9 NSOs to submit an to second an emergency proposal from them. The concept of small breakout groups wasn't clear to me, Thais. At the moment, at the World Scout Conference, up until 2014, we didn't have breakout groups around the draft resolutions. You basically got in your pigeonhole or through the website, you downloaded 36 hours before a document which gave an overview of all the proposed resolutions. And it was up to you as a delegation to go out and talk informally to other NSOs about how they felt about a particular proposal and develop amendments and then bring them live to the floor. What we're proposing here, because we will have the resolutions in advance, the draft resolutions, is we're going to organize small breakout sessions. During the conference itself on the second day, so if, for example, Belgium is proposing a resolution on the Jamboree, for example, you will actually be invited to run a small session which will be in parallel with other proposed resolutions, where you will be offered the opportunity to explain why you feel it is important to a smaller group of people that there is a resolution around the Jamboree, and you will be able to have a discussion there with this group of people around it. So you will not have to search for people yourself, but there will be in the agenda space for, say, the proposed resolution of Belgium on the Jamboree, and people will be able to join that session itself. Instead of having informally to go to a hotel, find where the people are in a small group. So there will be a place in the agenda for that. I hope that clarifies the small breakout groups. It was about the youth forum resolutions, but you say it's answered. Okay, so I think it's answered very well. Okay. I see Mr. Jordeman, the International Commissioner for Belgium, is now feel obliged to draft a resolution on the Jamboree. I'm very sorry for that, Jo. But you can, of course. I mean, I'm just giving examples here. Okay, many NSOs decide their delegations quite late. I see Celia asking, yet the members of the resolutions committee have to be part of their national delegations, right? Why is the deadline for applying to the resolutions committee so early? Yes, members of the resolutions committee have to be part of their national delegations. At the minimum, they need to be endorsed by their national scout organization. We will not have members of the resolutions committee who are not backed up by their specific NSO. They don't have necessarily to have to be a delegate, like one of the 6 voting. They can be an observer. But yes, we want them to be part of an NSO delegation. This is how we have done this in the past. Why is the deadline for applying to the resolutions committee so early? Because we want this resolutions committee to be in place early, because we will have draft resolutions coming in much earlier due to the earlier deadline. And so we want to have a resolutions committee which can already work from April onwards with NSOs to help them to draft resolutions. Like if the NSO from Costa Rica is developing a draft resolution and they need support, we want them to have a go-to person to go to. And this would be the resolutions committee, which would help them to, if they need technical support to develop the resolutions committee, but also afterwards to facilitate online discussions with Costa Rica and other NSOs interested around a topic like the mood. For example, if the resolution is about that, so that can be facilitate. So that's why we want the resolutions committee to be appointed early, because if they are only appointed, as was the previous practice, at the conference itself, there is no neutral body available prior to the conference, and we believe the resolutions committee is this neutral body who works with the NSOs on a technical level with resolutions. So I hope this answers the question why. But again, they don't need to have to be one of the six voting members. That doesn't matter. We just want members of the resolutions committee to be backed up by the NSO. And we will release an open call in January already. So there's sufficient time for NSOs to consider candidates. So thank you for asking this question, Celia. We'll now take the final question. So the World Scout Youth Forum will only be able to present through an NSO amendments to previously sent NSO draft resolutions. Right, is Mario asking. The answer here is twofold. It will be able to present through an NSO amendments to previously sent NSO draft resolutions, yes, and those amendments will be made sure that they are NSOs when there are small discussions happening during the World Scout Conference on the different resolutions. We will make sure the participants are aware of the amendments proposed by the World Scout Youth Forum. Now, just as the World Scout Conference is able to file emergency resolutions, NSOs can file emergencies at the World Scout Conference, the World Scout Youth Forum could, if there is an urgent and important need, develop a draft emergency resolution and then at the conference try to find nine NSOs supporting it. So that option is also still open to the World Scout Youth Forum. It would, of course, have to find during the conference nine NSOs to back it up. But again, it would already be together for 5 days, the World Scout Youth Forum, and already will have an option to find initial buy-in from NSOs. So this could move pretty quickly. So the answer here is they can amend the previously sent NSO draft resolutions. And if the World Scout Youth Forum feels there is an urgent and important need for an emergency resolution to be considered by the World Scout Conference, it can develop such one and then at the conference itself, search for the buy-in of such a resolution. I see there's a sub-question here. I also didn't understand how the World Scout Youth Forum proposals will be added to the World Scout Conference docs for implementation. So as I just explained, they will be integrated in the discussion sessions. We'll make sure that anything coming out of the World Scout Youth Forum is tabled in the breakout sessions on the different resolutions. I know some of this, seeing from the questions, that some of this sounds maybe complex for you, like how exactly will this work, this transfer between the World Scout Youth Forum and the World Scout Conference, and how will this amendments to amendments work in plenary? We're not saying this is, these changes will bring hallelujah to the world. I mean, these are changes. We believe, I mean, we have reviewed them intensively with what other NSOs and other INGOs are doing. We believe that they will bring a more streamlined, inclusive process to the World Scout Conference, have more relevant resolutions, and have lead to more informed decision-making. But we will have to learn from this. We will have an evaluation session specifically at the end of the World Scout Conference, and we will particularly consider inputs on that, and we will have to learn from this. Maybe we will see that we need to tweak some things in 2020 to try to do better. But I mean, if we don't make dare to make changes, we will never. I mean, we will never move forward. So we know these are a couple of radical changes, and we believe, based on international best practice, that these will help to move us forward. But again, we will foresee evaluation time at the end of the World Scout Conference and also afterwards to consider with NSOs if you if this went well or if there are still areas for improvement, and we'll take these forward to the 2020 World Scout Conference. If you have further questions as well, which might happen after this session, also all regional committees have been informed of these proposals and are supporting these proposals. So if you have any questions, you can also turn to your regional office or regional committee to further ask. And you can evidently also email to resolutions@scout.org and we'll try to answer those or post them on the event pages on Facebook. Finally, don't forget, one of the reasons we're doing these Q&As is we need to actually decide if you agree with the rules of procedures proposed by the World Scout Committee. So we hope you will cast a vote, and preferably by the 8th of January. So this will help us prepare the 41st World Scout Conference timely. So I thank you all for joining this session, for all the questions asked and for taking time. There will be a second English session on Friday, if you missed this one, and also on the in the four other working languages in between now and Friday, if you're interested. Again, thank you very much, and enjoy the rest of your day.